Hello, and welcome to Maths with Jay. Here, we're going to see how we can use Fermat's little theorem to find the least residue of a really big number. Another way of thinking about what we're doing here is that we're finding the remainder when we divide an enormous number by a prime number. We're going to look at three examples. The first one will be looking at a relatively small number, just so that you can check that we have got the right answer on your calculator. But usually you'd be applying this method to numbers so big that they just wouldn't fit on your calculator. So let's have a look at the theorem to start with. Well, it looks pretty simple. If we've got an integer a, and we raise it to a power, and that power is related to the prime number p, so the power is p minus 1, then we know Fermat's little theorem tells us that that number is congruent to 1, and here we're working in modulo p. So another way of looking at what this is saying is that when we divide a to the power of p minus 1 by p, we get a remainder of 1. Now this works for any prime number p and any integer a, so long as it isn't divisible by the prime number p. So what we're going to do is we're going to start with a number, as I said, that would fit on your calculator so that you can check the answer. So we're going to start with 2 to the power of 16. So we're going to find the remainder when it's divided by 17. Now, if we just look at Fermat's little theorem over here, well, our a is 2. And I said we're going to be dividing by 17, or we're looking at mod 17, modulo 17. So our p is 17. So 2 to the power of 17 minus 1 is going to be congruent to 1. So all I'm doing here is substituting a as 2 and p as 17. And 2 isn't divisible by 17, so no problem there. The theorem is going to work. Now 2 to the power of 17 minus 1, well that is 2 to the power of 16, isn't it? So what we're being told here is that 2 to the power of 16 is congruent to 1 modulo 17. So what we found here is that if we divide 2 to the power of 16 by 17, then we get a remainder of 1. So let's just see how we can check this on a calculator. Well, we could work out what 2 to the power of 16 is. So our calculator, let's just write down that we're checking this, 2 to the power of 16, our calculator tells us that that's 65,536. So we don't actually need to know what that is as an actual number, but it just helps, I think, to check what we're doing. And what we're going to do is divide that number by 17. Oops. And that will give us 3,855 1/17. Now remember, we were talking about what the remainder was when we divide by 17. So in fact, the number here, this 3,855, well, that's really irrelevant. That's got nothing to do with the remainder. The remainder is this number here. So we have found that we've got the right answer and the remainder is 1. So 2 to the power of 16 divided by 17 has a remainder of 1. Another way of putting this is that the least residue of 2 to the power of 16 in modulo 17 is 1. And what we're going to do next is look at another power of 2, and this time it will be so big that you won't be able to get the number up on your calculator, or at least it's got, I think, 15, 16 digits, so it will be give it, your calculator will give you the number in standard form, so you wouldn't then be able to go on and do a division and check what the remainder is. Not on the kind of calculator I've got anyway. So let's just make a note of what 2 to the power of 16 is mod 17, because that's going to help us. So we're still going to be working with 2 as our base number and working with modulo 17. So this time we're going to be looking at 2 to the power of 50. So we want to know what the remainder is going to be when we divide 2 to the power of 50 by 17. Or another way of thinking about this is what the least residue is in modulo 17. Now we're going to be able to use what we've already done. We know that 2 to the power of 16 is congruent to 1. So what we need to do is we need to write our 50 in terms of 16. So let's have a look at this. What we're really doing is dividing 16 into 50. Well, it goes into 48, doesn't it? So that's going to be 16 times 3 and 2 left over. So what we can do is say that 2 to the power of 50 is the same as 2 to the power of, and all we're doing here is rewriting our index, rewriting the index 50 as 16 times 3 plus 2. And then, using our laws of indices, we can say, well, 2 to the power of 16 times 3 is the same as 2 to the power of 16 to the power of 3. Now, we've done that because we know that 2 to the power of 16 can be replaced by 1. So we'll do that in a moment, but let's just finish this off. So we also need to take account of the plus 2 in the index, so that's 2 to the power of 2. So that's just using our ordinary rules of indices. And now, using Fermat's little theorem, well, we know that 2 to the power of 16 is congruent to 1, so we can replace that by 1, so that's 1 cubed. And then 2 squared, well, we know that's equal to 4. So that's congruent to, let's just put in that we're in mod 17 here, modulo 17. And then 1 cubed is the same as 1. And 1 times 4 is just 4. So Fermat's little theorem has enabled us to say that when we divide 2 to the power of 50 by 17, we get a remainder of 4. Or the least residue of 2 to the power of 50 in mod 17 is 4. So that's a reasonably big number, but what we're going to look at next is an even bigger number. It's going to be one that's got, well, more than 300 digits, so really, really tricky to do any arithmetic with that. So the number we're going to look at this time is 4 to the power of 532. So a really enormous number. This one has got more than 300 digits, so it would take forever to write down the number, let alone divide it by anything. And what we're going to do here is work out the remainder when we divide it by 11. So we're working in modulo 11 this time. We're going to find the least residue of 4 to the power of 532 in modulo 11. So let's have a look at how we apply Fermat's little theorem. So A this time is going to be 4. Our prime number is 11, so 4 to the power of 11 minus 1 is congruent to 1 mod 11. And of course, we can then write this as 4 to the power of 10, congruent to 1 mod 11. So what we need to do here is we need to write 4 to the power of 532 as 4 to the power of 10 times something or other plus something or other. So let's just write down over here what we're doing. 532 is 10 times, so we're dividing 10 into 532, so that goes in 53 times. That gives us 530, so we've got two more there. So that's going to give us 53 here, plus two. So that's just ordinary arithmetic on the 532. And then using our rules of indices, this is going to be 4 to the power of 10 to the power of 53 times 4 squared. Okay. And then, well, this is when we're going to use our fact that 4 to the power of 10 is congruent to 1. So this is where we're using Fermat's little theorem. So that this time we're using our congruent to in here, and that's going to be 1 to the power of 53. And then we might as well write down what 4 squared is. That's going to be 16. And we're in modulo 11. And then we can say that 1 to the power of anything is 1. And 16 is going to be, we're in mod 11, so let's take away 11. So that's 5 mod 11. So we now know that when we divide 4 to the power of 532 by 11, we get a remainder of 5, or the least residue of 4 to the power of 532 in mod 11 is 5.